And welcome back to the Spinner Rack, presented by Comics Remixed, episode 60. As always, I'm your host, Big B Brian Adams, joined by my co-host,
Junior Ruiz.
All right, man, we're going to just delve right into this week. You know, I was watching the news the other day. Don't watch the news a lot. Actual TV news, I think it might have been Channel 5.
I don't watch it at all.
Maybe Channel 7. And they did this little segment on women in comics. And, you know, the last episode, 59, we talked about sexuality in comics.
Yeah.
Maybe touched on diversity slightly here and there the last few weeks. But it made me realize, is this this small little, and I swear to God, it was like less than a minute segment on women in comics. I had a couple writers, they talked to Gil Simone for like just a snippet. They talked to the woman that's writing Wonder Woman, Hitch's wife.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it. And they really didn't talk much, but they made it seem like that,
Finch,
like,
not Hitch.
What?
Finch, not Hitch.
Finch. Okay, my bad. I almost said, I thought you said something else. But anyway, so they like made it seem like that, like, women in comic books is something that just doesn't happen. Like, you know, they went out of their way
like
to,
is
like,
this brand new,
yeah,
thing.
like Wonder Woman and Batgirl haven't had comic books, like, almost at a consistent basis for the last like 10 or 20 years.
There's just people that are out of touch. They don't understand it.
It's like news. It's like I feel like it's like, oh, this is popular, so we have to talk about it. You know what I mean?
Right.
And they said that 47% of the fan base for comic books is women.
Yeah.
Really? That surprises me.
Why?
I don't know. It just does.
Nah, man.
Because I can tell you right now, on all my trips to the comic book store, I see way more dudes going than I do women.
When I was working at the comic store, I would see, I mean, I saw, yeah, more guys, but the share of women that came in, it was a pretty big number.
Yeah.
Like, for every two guys, one chick would come in. You know, there were always a lot of women in comic stores.
Like, as much as we talk about ethnicity and sexuality in comic books, like, the women representation, I've never really even, I just didn't think about it.
Right.
But, I mean, there's plenty of creators out there. I don't think there's as many female writers as we think there are, though.
There's a lot.
You know, are there? Maybe I'm just not reading their books.
You know what I think? I think when this world blows up and we all start a new, or not we, but a new world starts, you know, like after the end of days or whatever and all that stuff,
uh-huh.
I think the roles will be reversed. I think the women will be the more dominant and the men will play the second role.
Yeah.
I think so. Women are due for it.
Wasn't that how it is in most of the animal kingdom?
I don't know.
Like, aren't the women the more dominant role in most of the animal kingdom?
Mm-hmm.
Like, women are bigger. Like, if you look at, like, pack animals like lions, aren't women, like, the females, the hunters?
Yeah.
You know, and then look at spiders or insects. Most of the time, the females are bigger than the males.
Yeah, the queens.
And then, you know, once they get, you know, that daddy juice, they eat the men. So we're kind of lucky that we're not, you know, we're lucky we're humans and not a bug, I guess. Well, that really has nothing to do with comics.
Are we really? Because as humans, we've got to worry about so much more.
Well, yeah, totally. But, I mean, at least we don't have to, like, you know, worry about, you know, getting our head bitten off after we get ours, which would suck. I mean, I bet you there'd be a whole lot...
Insect virgins.
A whole lot more virgins if that stuff happened to humans. You know? There wouldn't be as many issues with...
Only on a comic book show,
yeah, people. Only on this show.
You know, D23 was this past weekend.
That's the Disney...
the Disney Expo.
I did know that.
I want to read this really quick. I was looking through... GeekNation.com had a excerpt or whatever. I'm just going to read it word for word here. D23, Doctor Strange concept art and details revealed, plus first Civil War footage.
Ooh.
The D23 Expo kicked off with Disney Legends Awards ceremony and their Disney Animation panels, which included looks at the new films from both Walt Disney Animation and Pixar. However, there's no denying that today is easily the biggest day of the Expo as the studio prepares to show several thousands of people new information and looks at their future Marvel, Disney, live-action, and Lucasfilm projects. The presentation kicked off with Alan Horn coming out and thanking Bob Iger for bringing all these studios and properties together and previewing what's to come throughout the presentation. So, and who's up first? None other than Marvel Studios. Kevin Feige walked out as the audience erupted in applause and thanked them all for helping the Marvel Cinematic Universe get to where it is today. Now that Phase 2 of the Marvel Cinematic Universe is completed, though, it's time to talk about the studio's 2016 Phase 3 films, Doctor Strange and Captain America: Civil War. Unfortunately, since production for Strange has yet to begin, there is not any footage to share. However, Phage did show the audience concept art for the film that featured looks at alternate dimensions, hundreds of cars flying into the sky above a city, and action between several of the characters, and also the first official look at what Benedict Cumberbatch will look like in the full Doctor Strange costume. The images continued and gave glimpses at Stephen Strange's arc into becoming the Sorcerer Supreme, as he starts out as a successful and cocky neurosurgeon, but due to a tragic accident, loses the ability to perform surgery anymore. Looking for some kind of salvation, Strange encounters the Ancient One, who is played by Tilda Swinton, and begins to turn into something much, much more. While Benedict Cumberbatch was unable to be in the hall for today's presentation, he's currently performing in a new adaptation of Hamlet, he did send a video message for the audience. The actor talked about how excited he was to play a character that will bring an entirely new aspect to the Marvel Cinematic U, and promised the film will have an astral projection and a lot of action and excitement that fans of the Strange character have been hoping for. If one thing's for sure, it looks like Doctor Strange may end up being Marvel's most out there film yet. It's funny that they say that, because I remember reading that. Have you watched Ant-Man yet?
I have not seen Ant-Man yet. I'm waiting for the DVD.
There's a scene towards the end where Marvel plays with, oh God, I don't even want to say obviously there's special effects, but just the only way I can compare it is when you look through a kaleidoscope,
uh-huh,
and you spin it and you see all these different shapes and just the way it is. Now picture that on screen in a movie with a character in the middle. It was some weird, weird, trippy stuff, man. But it was good. Like, the way it was presented, it was awesome. They say they're going to take that and incorporate that kind of stuff into Doctor Strange, and you're going to see a lot of it. So, but moving on. That was it for the Doctor Strange presentation. And then it was time for the one that everyone's been waiting for, Civil War. Anthony Mackie took the stage to begin the panel, who flew out from Germany to be at the hall with the audience. He announced that only 1 week more of filming remains for Civil War, and then revealed that he wasn't the only one from the film's cast there, as Captain America himself, Chris Evans, was welcomed with a massive applause. Evans spoke briefly about how much he loves Disney movies and how happy he is to be part of the Disney family now, revealing that whenever he's feeling down, he watches home movies of people going to Disneyland. So to all those people who made fun of me for spending hours watching videos of kids finding out they were going to Disney World, take that. Captain Freaking America does it too. That wasn't me. That was from the guy who's writing this article.
Right.
However, that wasn't all. Evans quickly teased the audience and revealed that they did, in fact, have footage to show from the film, as the crowd got to see the first official trailer, maybe, for Captain America: Civil War. The footage was packed to the brim with exciting content that included a fight scene between Cap and Crossbones, Black Widow fighting Hawkeye, Ant-Man meeting Captain America for the first time and totally geeking out, War Machine fighting Cap, glimpses of Iron Man, a new look at the Black Panther, and more. From what it seems, the two sides fighting each other will be Cap's team, himself, Hawkeye, Scarlet Witch, Ant-Man, Winter Soldier, and Falcon, versus Iron Man and War Machine. The battle appears to have been sparked by a speech made by William Hurt's General Thunderbolt Ross, in which he insinuates that some of the heroes have begun to act more like vigilantes. Tony seems to be calling for more accountability for superheroes following the events of Age of Ultron, and as the trailer progressed, the tension between the former team members seemed to grow. Two of the more notable interactions in the teaser came when Tony told Steve, "Sometimes I just want to punch you in your perfect teeth," and Black Widow asking Hawkeye, "Are we still friends?" during their fight, which with him replying, "Depends on how hard you hit me." Oh, and Bucky will indeed finally be stripping away his Winter Soldier history and joining up with Steve in the film. So for those of you hoping to see that arc from Captain America: The Winter Soldier continue, it looks like you'll be more than pleased. That was it for the Marvel panel, everyone, but judging by the footage shown from Civil War and the Doctor Strange concept art, it looks like the Marvel Cinematic Universe is about to get even larger.
Awesome.
And peace.
You know, it's really funny that Cumberbatch is actually going to be Strange, because there's been so many conflicting things. Like, I think a couple months ago we had said that he was on, and then we had said that he was off. And obviously he's now on.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I can't wait for that movie.
I think that was just a rumor that you had read.
Yeah. There seems to be a lot of that going on. Spider-Man costume, I know I saw a little bit of that. I heard there's going to be two versions. I've seen leaked pictures of what appears to be the first version of the costume.
Really?
And I guess he gets a more traditional looking costume from Iron Man, according to the article I read. That movie's going to be interesting to see, because it's going to be, like, I'm really curious about how they're going to pull off that story without so many elements in play.
I could understand that.
It's curious, because it's one of those things to where it's like not confined to the space of what they have cinematically.
Yeah.
Whereas most of their movies have been up to this point. That's gonna be an awesome movie, man. I really, really can't wait for that. Unlike Fantastic Four, which bombed at the box office last weekend, Brian, $26 million. We've pretty much went on record here as saying that this did not look like something we wanted to see, and we're pretty sure that it was just going to be a big piece of trash.
Okay.
I don't think it helps things when the director of the movie, on the eve of its release, tweets out that, this movie basically is going to be a big piece of crap, and it's nothing that I wanted to see, and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it's just...
Like, I remember reading that. Didn't he say that he blamed the studio for taking so much out of it?
Yeah. So, the funny thing is, I've become more interested in the behind-the-scenes stories of the making of this Fantastic Four movie than the movie itself. Which, from everyone that I've heard from, except for Lou Bernal, it sucked.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Lou's the only person that said he liked it.
Yep.
But then, you know, and then there's some people that... I've heard people say that it sucked if you looked at it as a Fantastic Four movie, but if you, like, just wiped it and didn't consider anything that you knew about Fantastic Four, it was... Yeah.
Nah. So that's, I like how Dennis Barger paid for a ticket to go see Ant-Man and then went to watch Fantastic Four because he refused to give Fox his money.
Yeah, I told him. I like your style, sir.
Yeah, that was smart. That was very smart.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it looks terrible, and from what I've heard, it just sounds like... It seems to me like, you know, first of all, like, I think half of the problems with these other studios that own Marvel properties and them failing on these movies is that they're just not looking at the source material. Like, and somebody, I read somewhere that someone was trying to say, oh, you know, the reason that Marvel does so good when they make their movies is, you know, they don't have to fall straight to the source material, but they're faithful to it. And I'm like, dude, you must be high, because when Marvel makes these movies, 9 times out of 10, they're, like, super faithful to the source.
Yeah.
Like, that's why Marvel's done well with their movies, is they understand their characters and they're faithful to... Like, this movie obviously was just a hot mess. I don't know what the studio was trying to do. I don't know what Trank's vision was. But, you know, everything I've read's been horrible. I've heard that he, like, hold himself up in the tent, and, like, that he wouldn't talk to people during, like, the shooting, and that him and I believe Miles Teller, the guy that played Mr. Fantastic, who Trank pushed for having cast, like, I guess they almost came to blows on the set.
Jeez.
Because he's really sarcastic and the director was kind of just, like, standoffish.
Yeah.
And then I heard that he was, like, super, like, demoralizing to Cap Mora, that he, like, treated her like crap because he didn't want her in the film. So it just sounds like, you know, it's...
Like, it was just a big mess to make.
Just a hot mess. A hot mess, you know. And I feel sorry for that Cat Mara girl, because, you know, it's like, she's kind of new to this thing. You're doing something you think is going to be great. Like, how much does it suck for these young guys that are on this movie, and they're thinking, man, this is going to be good for us, and you just are involved in, like, the hot mess of hot messes.
Yeah.
Like, Marvel fanboys that want to talk crap about how Batman versus Superman, John of Justice is going to be a heaping pile... Dude, this is it. This is your heaping pile. Dawn of Justice is going to be awesome. If you think it's going to suck, like, clearly there's something wrong with your brain and you just hate stuff for no reason. But this is the steaming pile of comic book movies. for now.
Speaking of Dawn of Justice, I was talking to Alex, and he was telling me he couldn't remember where he saw it, but he swore he saw a leaked photo or an article or something basically showing you who the main villain of Dawn of Justice was. I took it with a grain of salt because I haven't seen it, and he said he didn't remember, so. And it could have been fan speculation.
Who was it?
Doomsday.
I've heard rumors that that's what it is, too. Hmm. But I don't really see...
I can't see them doing that.
I don't see that. That's like a heavy hitter right out the gate. That's a little too much.
Yeah.
That's a little too much.
I think there is no main villain in this movie besides Lex.
Yeah, I don't think... I really think...
And I don't even see looking at Lex as the main villain. I think you're going to get your action villain sequences between Batman and Superman themselves.
Mm-hmm. No, that's what it looks like it's going to be to me. I mean, I don't see it working any other way. You know, speaking of that, and this is something I actually had planned and wanted to talk about after I got past this hot mess of Fantastic Four, which, Jesus, I mean... Like, seriously, if they could put a documentary on the making and everything that's come out of it, that would be absolutely interesting to see. I would totally watch it.
I would definitely like, who is it that does it? Lifetime or whoever makes those, you remember how they made that unauthorized Saved by the Bell?
Yeah.
And then next week they're doing the unauthorized Full House.
Oh, really?
Yeah, nice. Which I've seen the trailer to. Looks good. I'd like to see them do the Fantastic Four behind-the-scenes stuff.
So, what is it with fanboys and hating things that they haven't seen?
This pertains to the conversation we had before we started recording earlier.
Maybe.
About, kind of like how we were saying, you know, hey, look, there's a panel, and they know everything.
Oh, no, that's just the new fandom and the kids only read comic books from seeing a panel on Tumblr. No, this is totally something different. This has feeds into directly what I was just talking about. There's a difference in between Fantastic Four coming out and it critically and socially being panned as a horrible movie and seeing a 2-minute trailer of a DC movie and immediately being like, that's going to be a huge piece of crap. No one's going to see it. I don't want to see it. DC's putting too much into it. It looks like crack. It looks stupid. It looks dumb. Dude, how can you judge that off of 2 minutes? 2 minutes. You don't know if it's overloaded. It's 2 minutes.
The same can be said for you and Suicide Squad.
Yeah, but that's different, though.
How? Please explain.
It's very different. Like, first of all, I don't like the treatment of the characters. I don't like the way that anything looks. Now, I have also went on record and said that I will see that movie. And that if I'm wrong, I will vocally admit I was wrong. Unlike these fanboys who just want to call stuff and they don't want to, like, give an explanation outside of that. You know what I mean? It's just like, ugh, this thing is going to suck, and I don't care what you think, and blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? I don't understand it. And you know what? And I hate to put a label on them, but it's Marvel fanboys, dude. It's Marvel fanboys. Because it's not I haven't heard anyone that's, okay, I have seen people that are DC fans, be like, oh, this movie looks like crap, but I just don't understand how you can... I don't get it, man. Maybe it's because, like, I saw that 2 minutes and 30 seconds of footage, and I was like, yes, I'm excited about this now.
What movie are we talking about?
Dawn of Justice.
Gotcha.
So I don't understand, like, the unwarranted fanboy hate. Because it gets, like, just out of control.
I don't know, man. I just... Who cares?
Like, I just don't understand it. Is that what the world has devolved to? Is just people with terrible opinions, and we have this way of just putting our crap opinions out there for everyone to hear?
I posted a meme earlier this week on Facebook, and it says 2015, the year we will be remembered for, or was it the year the world was offended by everything?
Yeah, that's no doubt, man. That's factual. That's not even just being funny, it's true.
Yeah.
Oh. But I don't understand it. I just, you know, I can understand why, like, I've become, unless I really think it sucks, I've kind of become the type of person where I see something, if I don't like it, I just acknowledge it wasn't for me. I don't set about to, like, piss on it for everyone else.
Right.
Which is what I feel like these people do. It's like, they're the same people, okay, you haven't even seen Dawn of Justice yet, but you want to say that it's overcrowded and they're trying to do too much at once, yet these same people don't find a fault in Age of Ultron. Which, as fans, you know, we both know that movie had its problems.
Yeah.
And if you can sit down and be like, that was a perfect movie.
No.
Like, you are mistaken. Like, you are just too much of a fanboy that you're blinded by your love that you can't even see what's wrong with it. You just can't.
You just step back.
Yeah. And to prejudge something as the worst, like, DC and Warner Brothers are gonna fail just because of 2 minutes of trailer? Come on.
Yeah.
Just because Marvel did it so... Man, Marvel didn't do it so perfect. There were missteps. Iron Man was great. Captain America, First Avenger,
So-so.
The first Thor,
So-so.
You know, Avengers, so it was good.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we could go on about this all day, but whatever.
Did you, we've spoken before about the abundance of pointless variant covers that are coming out.
The Looney Tunes covers? Is that what you're going to talk about now?
Yes and no. Just themes lately that have been being released as far as variants and stuff. Like, just stop. There's no point.
Marvel's rap covers?
Yeah, That's where I was going. Marvel and DC have both caught my attention with the hip-hop album covers as well as the Looney Tunes covers. I've seen all the Marvel hip-hop ones. I love all of them. Some of them I can't recognize. Like, I don't know what albums they are. A lot of them I do. And I'm like, man, these are really cool. So I think I'm just going to go pick those up depending on price. I just want a set, you know. Now, the Looney Tunes ones, I've seen a few of them. I was like, those are pretty cool, too. So if I can find a store that'll set them all aside to me and sell them to me for one set, you know, as a price, I'll probably pick them up. Those look really good. And I'm just surprised that you don't see a lot more Looney Tunes crossover with DC stuff only because it's Warner Brothers.
Yeah.
You know, going now that I'm looking at it, Looney Tunes do not have any pops. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, no, there aren't any
Looney Tunes. There are not any Looney Tunes, which is very mind-blowing because Looney Tunes, you would have figured, was probably one of the first runs. And I know they're still catching up because they're just now coming out with Sesame Street stuff. But come on, Looney Tunes, how do you not have a Bugs Bunny pop already in existence? But you've got all... You can't tell me it has anything to do with rights because it's Warner Brothers and they've got all these DC pops.
Oh, yeah. That's actually quite an excellent point you bring up. I don't know. I mean, it's like Nintendo. You can understand why there's not Nintendo pops.
I want my Looney Tunes pops.
I don't know why Nintendo doesn't just be like, okay, go for it.
Yeah.
Because it's not like... I mean, and someone pointed out that there's Amiibos... But it's not the same thing, man.
No.
Amiibos are used for games. I mean, come on. Look at
Amiibos are mini statues. I've seen them. They're pretty cool. Yeah, I actually thought about totally cool. Buying Amiibos and the Disney Infinities or whatever. Those are pretty cool.
Yeah, it's the same thing. There's all kinds of Disney pops. There's all kinds of Star Wars pops. There's Marvel pops. And then there's the Infinity stuff, which they have Marvel and, you know, Star Wars. And
Disney. But there's no DC for that.
Yeah, no, there is.
I think Funko's got, dude, right now they're hitting a home run because they've got the license to pretty much everything. That's the one line, like, if you ever wanted.
It's like Nintendo.
Yeah. Why not? Video games, well, most video games in general. Why not?
Nintendo? Oh, they've just started doing video games.
Did they?
Mm-hmm.
Well, then, there you go.
But I don't think Nintendo will do it.
What about Sega? Like, I want a Sonic and Tails and Knuckles.
They've already been out.
They've done Sonic and Tails and Knuckles?
Sonic and Tails, yeah.
Oh, man.
Sonic, Tails, and Knuckles have all been done.
Yes, they have. Yes.
And they're probably about $50 to $60 a piece now.
F that.
Yeah, that's a little... Yeah, exactly. F that. Absolutely.
But I want my Warner... I want my Looney Tunes, and I want my... Dude, could you imagine? Like, they open the vault on that. You know, you get the Animaniacs pops. And you know how Funko goes crazy with putting in minor characters and stuff.
Yeah, totally.
Why not just not the Animaniacs? But give me the doctor, give me the nurse, give me the Warner Brothers exec, give me the security guard, give me Sally, Squirrel, give me the good pigeons, Squirrel. Give me all these guys. And that's just Animaniacs.
Yeah, totally.
Give me Freakazoid, give me Cosgrove.
Pinky and the Brain.
You know? Like, you can go on, man. Give me the Tiny Toons, the regular Looney Tunes.
Yeah, how come there hasn't been Tom and Jerry pop?
Yeah, right? Give me my Marvin the Martian pop already.
I think they're just
I will explode the world with my explosive P-13 explosive space modulator.
Nice. I think they're just getting there, man. I don't understand why they haven't separated.
Give me my Space Jam pops.
Like, they seem to, like, you know, they do these lines like TV, movies. You know, games is now a big one because as far Fallout. As games, they haven't done a lot. They've got Fallout. They've got Skyrim coming out.
I guess they've got the Sonic one.
The Sonics, they've already been done. Why with the animation?
Where's my Metroid? Where's my Zelda?
They need to separate the animation and have anime. Because anime has kind of fallen right into the animation one.
Yes, I've noticed that.
And I feel like that there's too much going on in animation that they should just create a subsect for anime, period.
Yeah, I can see
that.
Some
Death Note pops coming out sometime soon. I'm excited for those. Because that's pretty much where it's at for me. Like, I'm Batman and anime. You know, I've got my Dragon Ball pops. I'm going to get those Death Note pops. I got my Attack on Titan pops. This has become another pop episode.
Nah, I'm about to cut it off.
But, yeah, moving on. You know what? Speaking of pops and toys, there's been a big backlash about the lack of girl action figures. Do you see this as a problem? Because I know a lot of people do. Like, companies don't want to, and I don't know if we've talked about this before, but it seems like companies do not want to make the female toys for boys, failing to realize that not only boys play with toys. Boy toys. Quote-unquote boy toys. As a matter of fact, Target has now eliminated... Yeah, I was going
to say, does this have to do with Target?
No, but it plays into it. Target has eliminated the sections for toys. Now it's just toys. There's not a boy section, a girlfriend section. For now, it's just going to be toys.
Okay.
I mean, should they... Do these companies that produce these toys need to realize that there is a market for female characters for both boys and girls?
Well, first, let me say, I don't think anybody ever looked at it as, well, there's a boys' toy section, a girls' toy section. I always just looked at it as action figures and dolls.
Right. Because
it was always separated anyway, but I never labeled it. It's just one of those things you just, okay, that's the girls, is the boys. You know, or what it's technically meant for.
Right.
Harley will go through both. She's got action figures.
Yeah.
I will say, though, as a collector, every time I look through the Ninja Turtle figures, there's always April O'Neil in there somewhere. You know, she's not hard to find. The Power Rangers, I always see the Pink Ranger and I always see the Yellow Ranger. Star Wars, plenty of female characters in there that I always see on pegs. You know, like, so the Divas from the WWE figures. So, I mean, I don't get it.
Yeah, apparently it's a big deal. Like, it started with the Avengers Age of Ultron toys. There was that plane thing from the scene where, like,
Black Widow comes down
and it's not Black Widow in the toy, it's Captain America.
Yeah.
And people are, like, up in arms and that. And I guess there's not really Black... Like, Black Widow has gotten the snuff.
So had Gamora.
Yeah, totally.
Because but the Gamora stuff, it was on... It was actually started with the Gamora stuff, not the Black Widow. It was the T-shirts. Where it would be, like, Guardians of the Galaxy, and you had all of them on there except Gamora. She was not even on the shirt.
Yeah, what's the deal with that?
And now the Avengers stuff, too, when you see them advertised, there's no Black Widow on the shirt.
That's like the Avengers Age of Ultron DVD. Apparently there was a released cover... What the cover art's going to look like? No Black Widow.
Really?
Or Hawkeye.
Oh, well,
you know, if you want to get technical. But they've got Hulk, Iron Man, Thor, and Captain America.
The main four.
But no, you know, no Black Widow. It's a big deal to people. Well, it's another big deal to people, or at least me. Something we actually talked about on what should have been episode 59, but my computer ate that and we lost it, was Constantine. There was rumors that, you know, Constantine would be possibly making his return to TV, not in his own show. Stephen Amell had continued to tweet that he was still trying to hash something out with getting Matt Ryan and the Constantine character in the Arrowverse, and then the executive producer of the show also came out and said that, I believe it's a she, that she was working towards trying to do that. Now, at the time, when we recorded the episode that my computer ate that no one got to hear, we talked about how I had high hopes for that. Well, high hopes have seen fruition, and Constantine will be on episode 5 of Arrow this upcoming season.
Yeah.
Awesome. My feelings on this is if people respond well to the character, will CW give us a Constantine show?
If anything, Constantine, I see it being at home, maybe on the CW or even on the Sci-Fi Network. You know, that it wasn't a good fit for NBC. That's for sure.
And it was in the death slot for NBC.
What do you mean?
Like Friday nights, the time slot it was on is considered by people to be the death slot.
Yeah, this ain't the 90s where it's TGIF.
Yeah, no.
You know,
it was in just a bad time slot. I'm really hoping that, like, this will... Because, I mean, it seems like there's a good relationship between Warner Brothers and the CW. And they seem to be, like, just putting all kinds of shows out. I've heard there's possibility that we're going to get a Hawkgirl show.
Mm-hmm.
And that show, Legends of Tomorrow, hasn't even debuted yet. So, that says something when they have enough confidence in something that hasn't even been seen by the public yet. They're like, man, we're going to spin this out into another show.
Right.
So who's to say Constantine doesn't... Who's to say that with Supernatural ending, CW doesn't... Like, hey, we've got this niche here with these people that like these shows about demons and magical stuff. Boom, Constantine can fill the void.
Or who's to say that Constantine as a character does not get added to Heroes of Tomorrow?
It's true that.
You know, as a regular cast member.
Or who's to say we just don't get a Justice League Dark show?
Very true.
Where it's more than... I feel like that guy's a great actor. I liked the cast. I felt like the show was good. I liked where they were going with it. You know? And if anything, that character's popularity should rise. The new DCU Constantine title. DC, or... I almost call it DC. Constantine the Hellblazer.
Uh-huh.
I think they're about 3 issues in now. Really reminds me of old school Hellblazer stuff.
Nice.
Like, they have the new 52 version of Constantine, that book sucked. But this new Constantine the Hellblazer, dude, I'm loving it. It's been telling, like, single... There's an overarching story happening, but it's been kind of single stories so far in the 3 issues. Really reminds me a lot of Gotham by Midnight, I think.
Okay.
Which, I love that book. If you're not reading that book, like, Gotham City, but the horror side, you've got, you know, the Spectre, and it's... Great book. It's a fantastic book.
Well, speaking of the CW, what do you think the connection is? Or is there any? I'm assuming there is. Between DC Warner Brothers, CW, and the WWE. Only because we, as Arrow fans, we know Stephen Amell, and as wrestling fans, Stephen Amell has been partaking on Monday Night Raw, and he's also got a match this weekend at SummerSlam. And the reason I bring it up is not the wrestling-related aspect of it, but the fact that wrestling, or the WWE... is promoting it as a comic book fight. And, like, a lot of the cutscenes on Monday Night Raw and everything, they're all comic bookish.
I think that...
And then they don't say, you know... I mean, they have mentioned, you know, Stephen Amell, star of the TV show Arrow, but now they're full-on saying it's Green Arrow.
Yeah.
You know, Green Arrow, the comic character. And so there's got to be something there.
I think that they're just trying to tap into a market that's obviously there, and they're not...
They're just now realizing that it's there. Yeah.
It's taken them a while, but...
Well, I've always said comic book... comic books...
The crossover and, there is huge. And the fact that, like, you were telling those guys on WrestleZone's podcast, and you were saying that people overall in the wrestling media are looking over some stupid things toward kids, they're really, like, ignoring the vastness and the popularity of the industry,
mm-hmm.
and the massive crossover that there is in existence. I'm excited about that match. What I'm not kind of excited about is, did you hear that NBC's getting a new superhero show?
Yes.
And then it's going to be on Fridays, and they're billing it as The Office meets the DC Universe.
Yeah.
It's going to be a half-hour comedy based in... the worst insurance agency. What? Like, you guys didn't have faith in Constantine, which in my opinion had, like, a huge groundswell following on social media. Like, the fans were there to support that show. So much so that another network has been able to grab your star and your character and put them on another show. But you decided that doing an Office version of the DC Universe is just, like, whatever.
Somebody will like it.
Yeah.
Whatever.
That show won't last a season.
You don't think so?
It'll get one season and it'll be done. I'm sure. because they've already said don't expect to see any heroes on it, any big name heroes anyway.
Right.
So what you're gonna give us, like, D-list characters? What are we gonna get? Oh my God, what's that samurai's name that was on Super Friends?
I don't remember.
Guy in the green. I can't even remember his name now. There are so many horrible friends, so Super Friends that were just like
Apache Chief
D-list characters. Were we gonna get some Apache Chief? You know, that's just terrible. Freaking NBC.
That's funny.
That's you know, that's pretty much all I got. I'm excited to see Arrow come back and Flash come back and Constantine, baby. That really excites me, man. I'm a huge, like, Matt Ryan, I became a huge fan of him just because of Constantine.
Uh-huh.
I'm also a huge Assassin's Creed fan. Assassin's Creed 4 Black Flag, Matt Ryan actually does the voice of the main character.
Really?
So I didn't realize it until I started watching Constantine, and it made me a huge fan of his, because I spent like 90 hours with that guy probably. Didn't even realize it.
Nice.
I'm ready to hop back into the Caribbean seas and do some pirating with Matt Ryan again. Love that guy. I'm excited. But that's about all I got for this episode. As always, everything we do, Comics Remix to Facebook, Comics Remix Twitter, Spinner Rack Twitter. Check Alex's tour reviews, Remix reviews.
Out on YouTube right now.
UTZ.
He'll be back with some new ones pretty soon.
Some fresh episodes.
He's got to set up his setup, I guess.
Yeah. And well, the man just bought a house, so you got to give him time. He's got to get that massive collection redisplayed.
Yeah.
And get ready to do what he does best.
Definitely.
Website should be launching soon.
I was just going to say, still working on the website. You know, this is funny. As I'm scrolling through here, have you seen this?
Yeah, you know, that was something I thought about talking about, but we've ran over.
Really quick, I just showed him a photo of Bill Murray on set of the Ghostbusters movie wearing the outfit. As I was speaking with Alex yesterday, he was saying that he heard that this reboot is going to happen, but at the same time, they're also going to do a Ghostbusters 3. That doesn't sound right to me.
Yeah, no.
Two franchises with the same name running at the same time. So,
I don't think that's going to happen. I'm actually kind of pissed off at Bill Murray about it, though. Like, Bill Murray, this whole time, like, for years and years, dude, they've been trying to get Ghostbusters 3 to go through.
Yeah.
Ghostbusters 3. And Bill Murray has been, like, the one.
He's been
the wrench in the machine, dude.
Yeah.
He's the, you know, the one cog that just doesn't want to fit. And then Ramis dies, so really all your dreams are shattered now of ever getting a true successor to the Ghostbusters series, that now we're stuck with the relaunch. And then you hear, okay, Aykroyd's in for a cameo, and now we're getting closer, and they've like given us costumes with them, and now he's on board?
Right. A little bit too late.
What a a-hole. Bill Murray's a dick. I like Bill Murray, but really, it's just a dick move, man. Really upset with the Murray.
With the Murray.
But yeah, that's all I got, man. You got anything to add? The website up soon.
Working on adding a third podcast. If anybody would like to contribute any ideas, basically it's going to be a toy podcast. I'm thinking about making it very social. What I would need from everybody is basically to tell me about your hauls for the week. You know, you guys spot stuff around town, you know, in whatever town you're in. Hey, you know, this store in Dallas just got this display in of WWE figures. Let me know. You know, I want it to be an interactive show. Obviously, it won't be a live show, but I'd love to answer fan questions. You know, I love to talk toys via, you know, email, whatever the case. I want it to be very interactive. I've asked, you know, on social media.
Even if you're in another country.
Yeah. I've asked on social media, you know, if people would participate. And, of course, I get no responses whatsoever. People just like the post. It's like, just answer. Would it hurt you that much? But, so I'm looking to do one of those pretty soon. Haven't figured out a name yet. I've got a few in mind. I've got a recording schedule in mind. It's just, you know, I want to do it, but I feel it can be a lot better than what I'd like it to be.
I would just need fan participation as well. So if you guys are more than willing, just let me know. You can contact me at junior@comicsremix.com and we can go from there. Other than that, I ain't got nothing.
It should be good. Oh, my last thing. I was emailed recently by Richard Johnson, the artist on Captain's BB. Woohoo! I'm going to be a Zabibi character.
Nice, really?
Yeah.
Nice.
He said he was totally excited at my enthusiasm over it.
Nice, so and he listened to the show. Yeah, thank you for listening to the show.
Thanks for listening to the show.
Woo! Zabibi being published by RIA Comics.
Can't wait.
Shout out to Aaron Moore for that.
If I wasn't more excited, I was already super stoked about reading that comic book.
Yeah.
Now knowing that I'm going to be a character in it, even more excited.
Very nice.
It's awesome.
Very nice.
Thank you. Thanks everyone that listens. We'll see you back here next week for episode 61.
That's all I got.
Peace.